Yes, I don't know how to...
Don't get up.
Company. I am very concerned about your father, though. How is he today?
Well, he's just fine, thank you.
I would have come straight over last night had I been there when you called.
I know you would have. And everything worked out just fine anyway. I wouldn't have called you at home except that Daddy trusts you implicitly. When I didn't reach when I called Dr. Cunningham and he came over and examined him.
Yes, I read his report on a seizure.
Well, actually, Daddy was just having a little trouble breathing, and he took a pill, and he was fine. He was back to normal before Dr. Cunningham got there. I think that he must have exaggerated the report a little.
I doubt that, Tracy. Dr. Cunningham is a very fine cardiologist. I don't think you realize just how serious it was. I've been thinking about cutting back on some of my workload, and Dr. Cunningham is the man who's going to take care of some things for me.
Cutting back? Why?
Let's just say I tackled too much after the epidemic, and I'm just now realizing how exhausted I was.
It's funny you should bring that up. Gary Lansky and I were just talking about it.
No.
I was telling him how intrigued I was to know what went on in the hospital during all those weeks of quarantine.
Well, it was a terrible time for all of us.
That's what Monica said. That's all Monica said.
I better get back to my office.
What's the matter?
I still have a lot to catch up on, Tracy.
Oh, I know, after the epidemic. Well, I'm not going to let up on you until you answer all of my questions about those weeks in isolation. So be prepared.
All right, that's fine.
Yeah. Whenever I saw a man with something gnawing at him, it's Rick Weber.
I'm gnawing at Rick, Tracy, is you. A barrage of questions about a subject we both want to forget.
That is so strange to me. You know, everybody else who suffered through the epidemic talks about it freely, like Jesse, Dan Rooney, Steve Hardy, who almost died. Odd that you and Rick can't.
It's not that we can't, Tracy. It's that we don't want to.
What could possibly have gone on between you and Rick that would make you react so differently?
There are no words to describe the helplessness, the claustrophobia of being trapped in here all those weeks.
I think I can understand that, Monica, because I had the very same feelings when my brother trapped me in his office because his little wifey went running to him last night with news of Dr. Cunningham's visit.
Alan has a right to know.
Alan has a right to know a lot of things, Monica. That's supposed to mean. I told you the day we openly declared war against each other that I was not going to stop until Alan knew everything about his little wife. And, Monica, I mean everything.
Not to impress upon you the importance of following doctor's orders to the letter.
Alan, I spent my entire Easter Sunday hearing the same thing from your mother. I promised never to go anywhere again without my nitroglycerin. Now, please.
And just one more thing. No more strategy meetings with Tracy and Mitch about his upcoming campaign. I don't want to see you get yourself worked up.
You don't want to see me worked up, then stop lecturing me as if I were 12 years old.
Edward. Alan and I just want you in top condition so Rick can operate this summer, and you can go back to living the healthy, full life you had before.
I don't understand why Rick sent Dr. Cunningham to examine him instead of doing it himself.
Well, Rick's been transferring a lot of his workload to Cunningham lately.
So you tell me, but I'm going to have to bring it up with him during the meeting today. I mean, if he's the one that's going to operate on Dad this summer, then he's the one who should examine.
Probably Lila.
Good morning,
Lila.
How did you
see? Wonderful. And a special Easter greeting for you from your grandson.
Honestly, you spoke to Ned, huh?
We did. Mother and I called London just before we came up.
And I proudly add, I finally persuaded Tracy to bring Ned over during the summer holidays to visit us.
Tracy, we would just love it if Ned would stay with us at the new house.
Well, that's very sweet of you, Alan, but Ned will stay with his mom.
Oh, Tracy, we've got the river, we've got those acres of land. I mean, a child can't be very happy in a hotel.
Oh, contraire, Monica. Ned's a very urbane little boy. He loves hotel living with all the trappings.
Maybe he's changed. It's been a long time since you've seen him, hasn't it?
Monica's here. I forgot to show you this yesterday. Now, don't you think that this wallpaper and this fabric would look just perfect in the nursery in your new house?
Full blue. Kind of stacking the deck on your mother.
But of course, dear boy. You know that I have my heart set on having a new grandson before next Christmas.
Gee, Monica, that doesn't leave you much time, does it? Unless you've got a little head start that none of us knows about.
Lila, I've already decided what we're going to name him. Edward Allen Quartermain. Since he'll have to carry on the Quartermain name, I want to name him after my two favorite men in the whole world. Saying something about taking me to the hospital for an examination.
Well, I was just having some coffee, waiting for the results.
So you're alone, you can talk?
Yeah. Is anything wrong?
Yes, Gail, and I just had to talk to you. Alan is downstairs with Lila. They're making arrangements for your party. And I don't know if I can go through with it. I mean, Lesley and Rick there, and Tracy watching every single move I make, waiting to run to Alan with some of her clever remarks.
Well, I'm sorry you feel that way, Monica. Look, why don't you just postpone the party? I mean, Lee and I will certainly understand.
No, Gail, no. I mean, I want to do this for you. Besides, if I ever mentioned anything to Alan about postponing it, he'd want to know why.
Fine, so you'll have your party and we'll all survive. As far as Tracy's lousy cracks are concerned, Alan's so used to them by now, he probably won't give them a second thought.
Yeah, but he is going to wonder when Laura and Scotty won't even look me in the eye because they're both convinced I spent the night with Rick the night the quarantine ended.
Have you ever considered that everyone is going to behave very normally and politely so that there will be nothing that you have to explain?
With Tracy there, Gail? Come on now. My sister-in-law has declared open warfare against me. I mean, it's going to be like sitting on a keg of dynamite just waiting for her to light the fuse.
And I'll do my best to help get everything organized so that Monica can just relax and enjoy herself.
Thank you, Mother. I want everything to be perfect. It's our first party since the epidemic and our first step back toward normalcy.
Alan, a party is a party. If you have enough booze and food there, everybody will have a good time, right, Daddy?
And the right entertainment, of course.
Oh, there'll be plenty of that. I've arranged for it.
Tracy, I'm warning you. If you and Miss turn this into a campaign rally, believe me, I'm...
Thank you for reminding me, Alan. I absolutely forgot I was supposed to call Mitch first thing this morning. Will you excuse me?
If I guess. Mother, are you sure that the hotel kitchen can handle everything in the buffet?
Alan keeps asking me why I'm so jumpy and irritable, and Tracy keeps pointing it all out to me.
Oh, I just feel so responsible for everything that you're going through.
Oh, no, don't, Gail. I mean, this isn't your fault.
I just wish I had never sent Rick after you that night.
Gail. Gail, wait a minute. Sounds as though someone else is on the line.
Yeah. Yeah, it does sound different.
All right, see you later. Bye.
I guess I'm just Anne being an over-anxious host. I just hope that being with our close friends will prove to Monica that no matter how horrendous that epidemic was, it's over and we've survived.
Hi, Mitch. I'm really sorry I didn't get a hold of you this morning, but I just couldn't. Well, I'm up at Alan's and Monica was tying up the phone talking to Gail.
Lila, if you chose it, I'm sure it is perfect.
Ladies, can we continue this conversation over breakfast downstairs?
I'd love to, darling.
Well, what's on your agenda for the day, Tracy?
I'm going to do a little work with Mitch and Gary on Mitch's campaign, if it's all right with you, boss man.
As long as you're not late for your real job, Tracy.
Alan, I'd like to talk to Tracy for a few minutes. I'll catch up to you.
Okay, fine, darling.
Not fine with me, however. I'm late already. Well, then, a few minutes more won't matter. This won't wait, Tracy.
Call the dining room if you need reinforcements, Monica.
All right, Monica, let's get this show on the road. I've wasted enough time already this morning.
Well, I find that hard to understand, Tracy, since you've already wasted enough of your precious time listening to other people's phone conversations.
Monica, I don't know what you're talking about.
Wipe the innocent look off your face, Tracy, and tell me what you heard when you picked up that phone and overheard my conversation on the extension upstairs.
Gee, Monica, your paranoia knows no bounds these days.
Don't deny it, Tracy. I overheard you telling Mitch that I had tied up the line with Gail.
Monica, I simply deduced that you were talking to Gail. It used to be a toss-up between Gail and Rick, but you don't seem to communicate much with Rick anymore.
Just tell me what you heard.
Don't push me, Monica. You might be sorry.
Oh, is this another one of your veiled threats?
No,
not veiled. I'm giving you an out. You started the scrimmage.
Do you want to call it quits, or do you want to know exactly why I think Rick Weber doesn't call here anymore?
No, go ahead. I'm fascinated.
Okay, we've got two possibilities. Possibility number one, Lesley Weber got wise and told Rick to lay off, which would account for the ever-increasing embarrassment between you and Lesley when you lay eyes on each other.
And you don't know what you're talking about.
I said could, Monica. Possibility number two. A recent, tremendous acceleration or deceleration in your relationship with Rick, which would account for the same ever-increasing embarrassment when you and Rick lay off.
You are wrong on both counts, Tracy.
Am I? Well, maybe two wrongs make a right in this case.
You know, you were the one who started this little war. Not me.
Crying uncle?
Not on your life.
I'm not intimidated by you, Tracy, because if you've had to fight for everything in your life, you learn something called streetwise. And I would match that against your finishing school education any day of the week. You know, Monica, you'd make a very good opponent if you just learn to be a little more careful before you go on the attack.
Oh, I like to stop the attack before it starts.
So do I. But I'm at the advantage because I'm not hiding anything.
Well, neither am I.
You know, if I tell Ellen that you deliberately picked up the phone and listened in on my conversation...
Well, I don't think you're going to do that, Monica, or you would have done it straight out. That's what I mean about hiding things. Puts you at the disadvantage.
Tracy, you don't scare me.
Not one bit.
Oh, really, Monica? Well, then I guess I'm just going to have to fess up and tell you that I did not deduce it was Gail on the phone. I innocently picked it up and overheard your conversation.
And what did you hear?
You think I'm going to make it that easy on you? Why don't you just go over your conversation with Gail and think about whether you said anything incriminating or not incriminating? Because I'm not telling. Not you, at least.
Well, then I have nothing to worry about. Because I didn't say anything that you couldn't hear, Tracy.
Ciao, Monica. Have a lovely day.
Oh, I just wish I had never sent Rick after you that night.
What night is she talking about? Go after it.